I don't want you fired. I want you blacklisted. I want it so that no tech company ever hires you. Not Apple, not Google. I want Pornhub to shred your resume.
And here we go.
It's the comic book bullies.
Man, you come right out of a comic book.
It's the comic book bullies.
You will not die for me!
It's the comic book bullies.
Now I am the master.
It's the comic book bullies. It's the comic book bullies.
Welcome back to the Comic Book Bullies with Nerds and New Bully. Me host Leroy, a.k.a. Baby Kanks, with my co-hosts.
Yeah, this is Eli, a.k.a. Diggum Smacks.
There we go. We're back with another episode. Eli, you might want to check to see if the link is up. Like I said, I just got banned from Facebook. I won't say why I got banned from Facebook, but I don't know if we're posting this up or not, but we're just going to just roll with it. Just let it go.
Well, yeah, you do your spiel. Tell us about your weekend. What'd you have for breakfast?
Shit. non-gluten waffles. I don't know what the fuck. Anyway, let's get into it. We're just going to jump into this show because we actually got a full show, even though nothing happened, because I know you see the big Wesker banner right there. And no, it's not. We'll talk about it. We're going to go to it. First thing we'll talk about is the Hubble telescope. What is it? Hubble telescope? Not the Hubble telescope. It's not the Hubble telescope.
Webble.
Not Webble, not Weeby, not Webby. Sweetie? Some rapper's name, I don't know, Lil Wayne, some shit, whatever it is. It's a new telescope that came out that's got all these insane images that's out right now. That's one of the images we had in the background, and so we got the deepest images of space ever. We're live, Eli. We're on Facebook. We're good. Okay. I just did a cheat sheet and checked it real quick. So let me just show you some images real quick of the telescope. Eli, if you can Google, find out what the name of the telescope, because it's not Hubble. They said this telescope makes the Hubble looks like binoculars. So whatever this is, this is like some shit, you know. So like I said, we got that image of gas giants or whatever, you know.
James Webb.
That's
space telescope.
So it's not the Hubble. The Hubble, that's old shit. If you know what the Hubble is, you have gray hair. You're old. You need to get checked for the doctor to make sure your health is good next week. Take a look at this image. Now, if you zoom in, I can't zoom in on this one, but you actually see galaxies. There, this is like a million miles out right now. This is insane, you know.
You can see ET's dick,
right? and then they even got one where you kind of like zoom in on it and kind of like see, like really zoom in on space. And oops, I'm sorry, that's Erishim from Eternals, but still, the same concept. So, yeah, loving the space imagey stuff right there. I'm pretty sure the technology they're building is going to affect us later on. It's going to help us build more Xboxes and PlayStations down the road. So, yeah, love it. Yeah. That being said, Eli, we're just going to just jump into it. Like I said, we got a bunch of show because stuff you want to talk about, stuff I want to talk about, stuff we want to talk about.
A lot of girth to this show. A lot of meat.
A lot of bone, meat on this bone. But anyway, you're going to jump into it. Like, first thing we're going to start off with, like I said, everybody sees the banner. You're going to just jump into it and see what everybody wants to talk about, because we're going to talk about a show that came out this week. Now, honestly, I didn't plan on even watching this show until Eli told me about this show, because I couldn't even log into my Netflix account because somebody from Spain stole my shit, or Argentina, somebody like that, you know. So I had to call Netflix to get my shit back on, you know.
They got a number? Like, you can call them?
Yeah, they had a number on the website. I called like 8 o'clock at night, man. Yeah, shout out to Netflix customer service, because I didn't think they were going to answer. But they answered. They were like, yeah, somebody from Argentina got your shit. And they signed in with their email. Let me change your email. And blah, 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 stuff like that. So I'm like, cool. Okay. So I decided to watch it because I was off today. So I'm just like, let me just watch one episode of this Resident Evil. And I ended up watching the whole thing. Now,
8 hours later, damn.
8 hours later, because it was like 12 o'clock, something like that. I watched one episode, just see if it sucks. I won't watch it. First episode did suck, but I kept watching it anyway. I'm like, why did I keep watching this episode? Now, the reason I kept watching this episode, because of the plot. That's why I kept watching this episode. So I'm like, I'll just check it out, see what's going on. But like I said, this is a Resident Evil show, and the thing is about this show is that it's not a whole lot of Resident Evil. It more feels like generic zombie movies than a zombie show, with Resident Evil sprinkled out in between it just for the sake of it. Now, for those that don't know the video game, the weird thing about this game, like when I started watching this TV show, I started noticing that the show is canonical to the games. Like, mm-hmm. it all matches up. Like, it's for
actually,
instance, like
it's actually a continuation of.
Yes.
I thought it was going to be a reboot. It's like a continuation.
It's continuation. For those who don't know the show takes place in 2035, away from any of the games. But they reference the games and they reference the date of the games when all this shit happened. Yeah.
And the first Raccoon City and how it was.
First Raccoon City getting nuked. I'm like, well, damn, that was like in 2 or 3 or 1. I can't remember. It happened. It's a thing that happened. You know, they even talked about Wesker dying. Wesker, they even gave the date when he died. Like, yeah, Wesker died in 2009 in a volcano accident. Resident Evil 5 came out in 2005.
He died in a volcano
because that was the boss fight. Because he was the boss fight of that game. Yeah, so that's the crazy thing about it. I'm trying to see what is this right here. Oh, Baghead. Baghead is in the game.
Chainsaw Man. Yeah.
Chainsaw Baghead guy is in the TV show. It's short, it's brief, and I know isn't that Leatherface or Jason? Could be, but he is a boss fight in one of those games. So I like that's pretty cool. Zombie dogs are here, zombie spiders are here. That's Resident Evil. If it's not Resident Evil, you wouldn't expect that.
The Lickers.
The Lickers, they're in the game. Nemesis might be a thing, you know. But what is the plot about the plot about this game is why I keep saying game. TV show. The plot of this TV show is Wesker's kids. The whole thing is about Wesker's kids. Now, your mileage may vary about Wesker's kid. Now, the thing is, in the game, does Wesker's have kids? Actually, yes. So, in Resident Evil 6, I played 6 was the last one I played. 6, Wesker did have a son. His son did have superpowers. He was basically like Dante, Devil May Cry, doing all kind of weird shit, fighting zombies like that. Game sucked, but I was like, that's interesting. This has nothing to do with that. He's got 2 daughters in this one. And it's technically not Wesker's kids. I might spoil this TV show for you in a second, but let's get into this whole Wesker thing, because the show is really about Wesker's family. It's not an origin story about Wesker by any means whatsoever. Like, Wesker technically is dead in this, but Wesker is the main character. Because if you watch the TV, if you play the games, this is what Albert Wesker looks like. Albert Wesker is like one of the most vicious video game villains of all time. And this is what he looks like in the Netflix show. Yeah, big difference. I know people are all online. People don't even know there's a Resident Evil TV show. They're just saying, is this a new Blade show? Like, no, it's not Blade. You know, I know this is not Blade's little brother Butterknife. No, it's not that. It's not Billy Blanks doing Tybo. It's none of that. This is supposedly Albert Wesker. Now, Eli, I hate to get political on people, but we got to go there. Now, a lot of people are saying it's woke. It's the message, the agenda, when you do stuff like that. Now, the thing is, they keep wanting to tell me, okay, this is Albert Wesker. This is Albert Wesker. I don't know this guy. I know this guy. I've been playing Resident Evil since whatever, so when I see Albert Wesker...
Or Marvel versus Capcom.
I was just about to say that. Marvel versus Capcom. When you get in there, let me see what I get. Yeah, when you get in there, again, he was on Marvel versus Capcom, and he was a beast. He broke the game. Some tournaments banned Albert Wesker in Marvel versus Capcom because he was so vicious. You know, so this Albert Wesker, I know him from Resident Evil 5 when he just called me and he was just beating ass. You know, I like, so when I hear Wesker, this is where my mind goes, you know, bam, 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 all this shit right there. But no, the game don't, the TV show don't want you to think that. They want you to think this. And I'm like, so my mind is trying to rationalize this supposed to be Albert Wesker. My mind can't do it. I'm sorry, I can't do it. So, you can call me racist, whatever like that. I don't care. I think this was a bad turn, because when you turn Albert Wesker black, all of a sudden now he looked like low budget Blade. They should have known that when they did this. So that alone, I'm sorry, it knocked the show. The show has other problems. Don't get me wrong. It's not even the main problem of the show, but it is a problem of the show, because you're telling me it's supposed to be Wesker for fans of the game. Because you call yourself, if you call the show Resident Evil, of course it's going to attract Resident Evil fans, people that know the game, people that know the movies. And but you give us this and it looks nothing like Wesker, so that automatically takes you out of the game. And it's no knock on that actor. I know this actor. Isn't that the guy from John Wick?
The the courier or what's his name?
The hotel manager or whatever.
Yeah, booker or whatever.
And he's awesome in John Wick. You know, you see he has a bit part, but you look at him, you're just like, what's that guy's story? I want to know more about this guy, you know. And Eli, I've been watching The Wire this week. He's one of the stars of The Wire. I'm like, oh, that's where he came from. And he's awesome in The Wire.
It's been a while. Yeah. Was he on that? Shit, I don't remember.
Yeah, don't spoil it for me. I mean, if something happens to him,
no, I never finished that. I never finished The Wire.
Yeah, either. But he's on it. He's like the head sergeant, captain, whatever. Like, he's awesome in that show. So he's an awesome actor. He's awesome in this role. Like, he's one of the bright spots of this TV show. But yeah,
because it keeps... I mean, I don't mind the show is okay. I like the action and the shit going on in the future. They keep flashing back to this high school shit with the kids that I really don't give a shit about, which is sad because that's the majority of the show. But
right.
When he is on it, he steals those scenes. Like, there's scenes with him on there where I'm like, okay, I didn't know about this Wesker, but because of the performance, I'm into it. Like when he fight, when that dude, the chick's dad, when he was bullying his daughter and shit.
And as like, the species gay, he was like, that's like one of my favorite things I heard in a TV show this year. Even though the show sucks. But yeah, he was like, I don't want you just fired. I want you blacklisted from every tech company in the world.
Yeah.
Ooh, Apple's not going to hire you. Google's not going to hire you. Pornhub is going to tear up your resume. I'm like, oh, damn.
Yeah. I mean, that was a great scene. And that, I think that's where I started paying attention more.
Right.
Know? Where I said, okay, I'm going to give this Wesker a chance. And it seems like he seems to be the part that saves it for me. And the action. When it gets going, there's plenty of gore. There's plenty of zombie action and monster action.
Okay. You didn't make it to episode 4, did you?
I did make it to episode 4.
You didn't make it. So you saw the Jack Black lookalike guy?
The Baxter guy or whatever.
Baxter guy, whatever, like that. He looked like Jack Black. Yeah.
Yeah. When the whole zombie fight when they're all trying to escape and shit.
That was pretty awesome. I'm not gonna lie.
That was cool.
I was like, that's when I kind of woke up. I was like, oh, where did shit come from? You know.
Yeah. That was the one with the chainsaw with the dude.
Was the one with the chainsaw guy in it. Yeah. So that was in there. So like I said, he gave it the Wesker actor gave it 110%. It is just the fact that he was just miscast. That's all it was, though. But he gave it everything he had. What else we got? Like I said, what else is going on with this show? Now, like I said, the show is kind of whatever, and it's bad when you're watching it. But when it gets to episode 7, it gets so bad. It kind of entertaining because this the shit I'm talking about. Like when they start cloning Wesker and you find out that he's just a clone and his other clones like show up with the kids and they're talking to him like, yeah, I'm your uncle. Like, I don't know you, you know? And then Afro Wesker shows up, like Billy Blank shows up and then Fat Wesker shows up. So like that, I'm like, yeah, what? Like the show just gets so stupid. It just like, well, something's happened. I'm entertained. Okay. I'll go with it. You know? But yeah, that's what's going on. But like I said, they throw little Resident Evil Easter eggs at you. Talk about New Raccoon City. Talk about Umbrella Corporation. Like I said,
plus Village or whatever or 5? Yeah, it was 5 because aren't they in South Africa or something?
They're in Africa, not South Africa, because the way they explain it in South Africa, they say there's really not that many black people there. But in the game, when they're in Africa, they're like shooting nothing but black people, which was an issue when that game came out. Like you literally had zombie spirit chuckers in the game. Like, are you really sure you want to do this? But
I do recall that.
Yeah. So like I said, and that's the thing about it. Like I said, when it gets to like episode 7, it's like the Resident Evil show remembers this Resident Evil because Resident Evil isn't just like some horror movie. It really is a batshit crazy video game when it wants to be, you know. Yeah. And the show just started getting batshit crazy. It was like, well, I'm into it, but you gotta forget it's a zombie show, and then the zombies show back up, like, oh, okay, zombies. And they start getting the cloning and all stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah, and it's weird. Like these zombies, okay, they're not dead, but they can't hear.
They call them zeros.
Yeah, they can't hear and they can't see, but they can smell.
They can smell, yeah.
So I'm a little like, there's a little bit of inconsistency of how these zombies are, like, how they function. But I'm like, well, whatever.
Yeah, remember they said the virus mutates and the virus changes depending on the, so.
Like, because they're run, and they're okay, so they're not dead, so they can run. but then they like one attacks her and there's like a whole swarm of them and they don't attack her. Like the rest of them don't attack her. I don't know.
Right, they don't all rush one time. Like they take turns.
I don't get it. I don't get that. And like, you know, and then they're all trying to break into that room or whatever when she had the grenade. I'm like, how do they know she's in there? Like,
oh, I guess they can smell her or something. I don't know, because they say they go by smell, but I don't know.
I don't know, but they're like banging down the door. I don't know. Whatever. It's like,
like just go with it. Like I said, yeah. It's a zombie. And it's the thing, it's as far as zombie, it's a generic zombie show. You know, yeah. It's what you expect from a zombie show, no more, no less. You know. And honestly, as a Netflix show, it's a Netflix show, no more, no less. Now, Eli, I know y'all say Stranger Things is the greatest thing since sliced bread, you know. Throw every single Emmy and Grammy and whatever else is out there for me, but take away Stranger Things. This is typical Netflix shit for me.
Yeah, Stranger Things is pretty much keeping Netflix's lights on.
Right, because like I said, when every time y'all tell me to watch a Netflix show, y'all tell me to watch Cowboy Bebop, y'all tell me to watch Death Note, y'all tell me to watch He-Man, y'all tell me to watch all this other shit. This is what we get. This is the level of shit we get. No more, no less. I don't hate it, but if I had a choice, but it's some shit I'll watch in the background if I'm bored doing something else its own, which is what this was. Nothing I will ever go back to. Is something I'll just watch every now and then. I have an episode that's like, well, that was cool, you know. But this is the typical Netflix shit we get. I don't know. That's
pretty much kind of like The Watcher. I never watched the second season of The Watcher.
What is The Watcher? The Witcher. The Witcher.
The Witcher. Sorry.
The whatever. Witcher. I do think the Witcher. The Witcher is I don't know if we want to go to The Witcher, because it's like I kind of like it and hate it at the same time, because there's so many time jumps in The Witcher. I don't know what the fuck was going on in that show.
Like this.
But everybody else swear by it.
It has its moments just like this show. You know, I mean, when I first this came on, what, Thursday night or whatever night, that's when I first tried to. New Resident Evil. I'll give it a whirl. And I fucking fell asleep. I fell asleep for the first episode. Okay, maybe I should try this. That's when I told you about it. Everyone was talking about it. And I was like, that's when I asked you. I was like, are you going to watch it?
Well, no, the one reason people are talking about it, because like these other sites that get paid to do this shit, unlike us, you know, like IGN, GameSpot, all these people like that, they get like nines and tens. Oh, it's the best video game adaptation of all time. Like, what video game adaptation you been seeing? This ain't that. But then you go on like social media, like you talk to regular people. They're like, oh, this show is terrible. Like, oh, this show is mid. You know, nobody is saying, oh, you got to watch this shit. No,
like,
it's
even
not.
My kid who loves the Resident Evil games, he had like the like Revelations on DS and he loved all that shit. He was saying it picks up. It starts to pick up the more you get.
It does pick up. Yeah. It does pick up. I give them that.
You know. And that's it. And it does. And once you get, by episode, that episode four was awesome. I will say that was pretty cool.
Episode four was the standout show, because I was ready to write this whole show off till it got to episode four. I was like, let me check it out a little bit more. You know, Jack Black beating ass in this show. You know, zombie
the Mausers and shit, and Papa John Woo and everybody. And
so I'm like, I'll watch it to see where this goes. You know,
the chainsaw running around with the fucking zombie head in the backpack and shit. Like, this is pretty cool.
like I said, when the show remembers that it's based on a batshit crazy video game, it picks up.
Yeah.
When it just tried to be a regular zombie show, it's just like,
When it goes back to the CW flashbacks of the kids in high school, that's when
the kids dragged it down. The kids definitely dragged it down.
I really don't give a shit.
Right. Yeah. I'm like, and why? And it's like there's literally half of the show. It keeps cutting back to these kids.
It's kind of annoying. It kind of gets on my nerves. Like, hey, I want to see all the zombie shit. And oh, we're back in high school. And I'm like,
oh man. So yeah, that's all. So honestly, if you got time to kill and you're doing something and you're just playing a Netflix show, whatever like that, turn it on, watch first episode. That's it. But if you got better shit to do, don't do this. I did not watch this show because, I got to have material for this podcast. No, I do not give a shit. I will do something else. This is just
what I thought you said when you said, I'm on episode 7. I'm like,
I was doing something else. It was just on. I wasn't like, I'm doing homework. Nah, fuck that.
I was like, shit. Well, I better catch up then.
I could give a shit.
I didn't have to watch this.
No, I was like, it's just on. I'll just watch it. It's just like, whatever. But no, I didn't care about this show. I was like, whatever. So. Oh man, that's all I want to say about that. I think we can move on past Resident Evil, but yeah, this is nothing you got to watch. Don't believe IGN. Those who got paid off. Netflix paid those guys off. I don't give a fuck nobody say. They got cash money under the table. Yeah, give me how much for it over 9.5 out of 5? 300.
I've watched the what's her name? The what's that chick's name? The one with Alice. What the hell is that? I can't remember her name.
The movies, yeah.
Yeah, Mia Jovovich or whatever her name is. Yeah. Those movies. I've seen them all. Most of them are kind of dumb, but they're kind of stupid and kind of fun in some ways. The shittiest one of those is still better.
Guess what? Wesker looks like Wesker in those
Wesker
movies.
Looks like Wesker.
Like when you see Wesker, you don't have to like, is that Blade? No. Yeah. You know that's Wesker. Yeah.
Yeah. Like this show is not better than Resident Evil, the one that was on the roof. That's all.
I don't remember which one was.
That
which
one was actually pretty fucking cool. The one where they're on the roof and shit.
All those movies kind of blend together, kind of like whatever,
and kind of campy and stupid, but they're kind of fun, you know.
They're not boring.
They're entertaining, like you said. Yeah. They're entertaining. This is has entertaining moments.
Entertaining moments, then it cuts back CW, then entertaining moments is like too much whiplash, you know.
Yeah. Yeah,
and honestly, sometimes I got confused on the time. Like, are we in present time, back in future time, or I didn't know where we were sometimes.
That's why the first episode was so jarring, like that. Like, what's going on? Oh, okay, now we're flashing back, and you know, and it doesn't even say. It just kind of like, you know, we don't have those transitional edits, like.
And that's what fucked me up with The Witcher, because The Witcher was doing that shit, and The Witcher was even worse because it was like, oh, 200 years later. You're like, wait, what? You know, so that's what's going on with this show. So
we asked for seconds at home.
No nothing like that. Or, you know, like maybe had like a grainy feature on the back. No, it's just cuts. Like something that just cuts, you know, and just and you're just supposed to just know.
Or like a Coen Brothers flip film. It just cuts to black.
Right.
And then back, and then dissolves back in. And then here we are.
I'm like, Netflix, do better. This is why Netflix in trouble. This is why I didn't give a shit about my password being hacked for 2 months. Like, I wouldn't watch this shit. I'm watching The Boys. I'm not watching this shit. You know. yeah. Speaking of, because other shit I was watching. Wait, let's move on. Let's transition. We can talk about Ms. Marvel. I know you said you got to fell off on Ms. Marvel, and that's cool. You know. A lot of people fell off on Ms. Marvel. From what I've been hearing is that Ms. Marvel is kind of like the lowest viewed show of any Marvel movie yet. A TV show yet. Like people just aren't watching the show. So.
Yeah, I would have watched this instead of Resident Evil.
I'll put it like this. I enjoyed this better than Resident Evil.
But at the same time, I didn't
binge watch Ms. Marvel like, oh, let me just watch 6 hours of this shit. No, I took my time as Ms. Marvel so I could understand. I didn't binge watch with Netflix. Maybe if I watched episode week by week of Resident Evil, maybe I would have liked it better. I don't know. That's Netflix model. That's how they do things. So let's go from that. But yeah, about this show. I'm just talking about the show, about what I think about Ms. Marvel. Now that it's done, now that I can sit back and critique the whole piece of it. It's exactly what it is what we thought it was. It was going to be a TGI 90s TV show. It's Girl Meets World with Superpowers. It was that until it wasn't. All of a sudden, it became about globe trotting. They even have time travel in it. You're like, what the hell is going on with this? You know, and I feel like a lot of times people critique these Marvel shows because I feel like the TV shows should be movies and the movies should be TV shows. This should have been a TV show, but the thing was, it should have been a longer TV show. They were cramming in way too much stuff in there for 6 episodes. You can tell by the time they got to the last episode, they were rushing. So yeah, they should have. I mean, you had her going to Pakistan, meeting her family, meeting the lore, finding out, you know, she's half genie. She time travels to meet her great grandma, and she's at the time loop that makes her. So they said, fuck all the in-game time travel rules. No, we're just going to just make our own thing up now. So they just do that. And then we finally get back to the last episode where they go back to New Jersey. And now it's a commentary on police brutality and racial profiling. Like, wait, what? They even had like disclaimer up to say like that some scenes may be too disturbing for some viewers. I'm like,
I hate it when they do that. Yeah. And I think something like really brutal is going to happen. And nothing right. ever does.
Or nothing ever does. So your guard is up the whole time. It's just like, oh, yeah. nothing happened. Okay. It's pretty much as a Pakistani side of my family. Hey, Mark Elon. Okay. So you're Pakistani. Okay. Yeah. Tell me some more about that. Make some comments about that. Because I'll be honest with you. I'm ignorant of some stuff because there was something, there was one thing in Ms. Marvel that they did that I was impressed. And I was just like, oh, shit, I feel bad about this. So they talked about the British partition of India. I'll be honest with you. I had no idea about that. I had no idea that was a thing.
Oh, isn't that shit? Like, okay, I'm ignorant too. All I know about that shit is like from the movie Gandhi. So yeah,
Gandhi is in Ms. Marvel, I think. I think he shows up.
We're dumb Americans, sorry. Right.
So forgive us. I didn't know about this, but I did think that was very interesting when they went there. And I was like, oh, wow. Okay, because yeah, so Ms. Marvel, Camilla time travels to the British partition. Okay. You know, meets her family and shit like that. And I was like, and I think Gandhi shows up in there. You know, they basically talk about it and how it affected the family. And I was like, damn. So honestly, it reminded me of like when we watched Watchmen and they did the Tulsa Massacre. And it popped up like that. And like nobody else knew about this shit but us. I felt it like that. Because they said like the British partition was like one of the most brutal points of American, I mean, of human history also. And everybody's got a partition story like, you know, in an Indian Pakistani family. That's what we got. Why do myself, but ex's parents, I heard Pakistani stories about partition, whole family stories about just like a TV show. Yeah. So when they went there, I was like, oh, and that's why I said this show should have been longer. I like, if you're going to go here, don't cram this in for half an episode. Stretch this shit out. Let's see how Camilla feels about
being Disney-fy it.
They Disney-fied the fuck out of this. I mean,
because HBO that shit. Right.
They couldn't do it. They couldn't go that far. Dr. Doom, let's see what you got here. So the new Blade, not R-rated thoughts.
I knew it wasn't.
No, nobody thought it was going to be. That's one thing we got to understand. We got to stop expecting Marvel to not be Marvel. Marvel is Marvel. They are who they say they are. So we already knew Blade wasn't going to be PG-13. We already know it's going to be, they're not going to have blood. They're going to be suck plasma from people, whatever the fuck Blade does. So, you know, expect Marvel to be Marvel. You don't bother you not. That's it.
All the kills are going to happen off screen or some shit.
Right. Yeah. You're just going to hear some guy screaming, no, while it pans to the moon or some shit. You know, expect that, you know. But like I said, Ms. Marvel, like I said, when they went to the British partition, I wish they would have gave us more of that because that was some interesting stuff. They went for like half episode, then cut to. Now, here's the reason why they had the disclaimer. And I think some people are confused on why they had the disclaimer on that last episode. Because some people saying that they were advertising police brutality, and some people saying it was propaganda, which Marvel has been accused of a lot of times.
Copaganda.
Copaganda is a word. It's a word. It's a buzzword on Twitter. So what copaganda is when you promote the police and you praise the police and ignore any bad things the police are doing. They're saying that Ms. Marvel is a prime example of that. And I'm thinking it's not, because the main villain of this entire show is Damage Control. Now, the thing is, Damage Control, what they do on this show is that they actually kick in the mosque and they're looking for the kid when they find out that he's Muslim. So right there, you're racial profiling right there. And it's a funny thing because when they kick in the mosque, every Muslim in there just starts taking that paperwork. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We know the routine. There you go. Right there. It's all like, damn. So they know what's going on with that. But like I said, and they're racial profiling. It is a mosque, but the thing, and they show the cops as good guys. They show the cops like, everybody get back. So they show the cops in a good light. But what people aren't catching is that Damage Control is a stand-in for the police. So it's
you're thinking, dude.
I'm thinking, but when I saw it, that's what popped in my head.
You can't expect anybody else to think.
It's Marvel. Shut your brain off, you know. But I'm thinking that's what Marvel was doing with that. They were like, okay, we're not going to show the cops in a bad light, but we'll basically make the Damage Control cops. Everything that people accuse the cops of in the media, but you're going to have Damage Control do this shit. Just shoot this kid for no reason, racial profile him. All this, chase him down the street for no probable cause, do all this shit, disobey direct orders from one of the superiors. Damage Control were doing all this stuff. So I was like, man, that was some crazy shit, you know. So overall, I thought it was cool. But that's not the big thing. That's not the big thing, Eli. There was a spoiler, well, not a spoiler, but a stinger at the end of it. Because the main thing that everybody is talking about on this show is what they did to Kamala Khan at the end. Bruno says to her, I checked your blood your blood is different from the rest of your family after you got put the bangle on. Your blood has a mutation. And then you hear the theme song. I'm like, oh, what? So, yes, Kamala Khan is confirmed to be the MCU's first mutant. So they did it. They went there. You know, they saved it.
Take that, Comics Gators.
Right. She's a fucking mutie. You know what it is. Yeah, so that's what's going on right now. So, yeah, so she's a mutant. And people are still like, oh, you sure it's not like a Ralph Boner type situation where they're just yanking our chain? They're not yanking our chain. After the show went on air, Kamala Khan went on Reddit. She went on Reddit and did an AMA, asked me anything, and they basically asked her every single question under the sun, and they asked her, is Ms. Marvel a mutant? Was that a thing? She's like, yes, Ms. Marvel is a mutant. Kevin Feige called me the day before the show to tell me that I was going to be a mutant. And that should tell you right now that how much Kevin Feige hates the Inhumans. So, because he, I think he brought Black Bolt back just to blow his brains out. Just the only reason is just he get rid of them, you know. When Marvel is said regards to other phase four, so like now, yeah, like now, it's not in the past, anything like that. It's like normal times, like right now. So yeah, so it's not like a flashback, anything like that. It's in, you know, like the most recent thing. Yeah, but like I said, it was confirmed that she's a mutant. She talked to Kevin Feige. They also said that Kevin Feige borrowed, basically people complained about Ms. Marvel's powers, and basically said they ripped off another mutant with the X-Men called Armor. Armor pretty much had the same powers. She got this glowy thing around her. She can stretch. She can make armor around her, shell, stuff like that. So that's what Armor does. And basically said that Kamala Khan is taking her power. So we're not going to see Armor in the MCU at all times anyway, which I expected not, because Armor was a Josh Whedon creation, so I think they like screw that character. So, whatever. Thank you, Josh Whedon. You are the gift that keeps on giving. Captain Marvel shows up. Carol Danvers does show up at the end. People are confused about what happened at the end. Also, like, did Kamala turn into Carol Danvers? No, she didn't turn into Carol Danvers. They switched places. There was actually a thing that the original Captain Marvel, well, the original Marvel Captain Marvel, did in the comics with Rick Jones. I know people don't know who Rick Jones is. I'm not going to explain Rick Jones. Rick Jones was a thing. They will never use him in the Marvel Universe, but that's okay. But anyway, wherever Carol Danvers was, that's what Ms. Marvel is now, and they'll settle that in the Marvels movie when it comes out. So,
the Marvels movie, huh?
Yeah, the Marvels. So basically, they were saying that all these characters will return in the Marvels. So we don't know
anything about
that.
Is that a movie or a show?
Movie. It's going to be a movie. The movie is going to be Ms. Marvel, Captain Marvel, and Monica Rambeau. Those three, and they're like the main characters. Yeah. Comes out next year. Yeah. So that's the thing.
Take that, Comic Skaters.
It's like three times the people you hate. You know? Look, the only thing that would get me excited about that movie, and the only thing they need to do is make Rogue the villain. That's it. That's all you need to do. Just make Rogue the villain. Have it just wrecking shit, just beating the shit out of everybody, sucking Miss Marvel, Captain Marvel's powers. There you go. That's the movie. $1 billion right there. Marvel, I'm giving you a $1 billion idea. Just do it. Yeah. So that's all I got with Ms. Marvel. Like I said, it's not the worst Disney Plus show, but it's not the top one either. I rank it like right above Hawkeye, but it's cool. I'm glad the show exists. That's the thing about it. I'm glad representation exists, because it's a good thing to see brown Muslims in good representation. They're not terrorists. They're not any other crazy shit that they show on TV. You actually show them in family life, and you show them in mosque and worshiping. And I'm like, I'm not used to seeing this. And I've seen reviews on TV. I mean, I've seen reviews on Twitter. Some a brown Muslim that stays in New Jersey. He was grown as hell, like in his 30s, but like that, was crying his ass off, crying his eyes out, reviewing this shit. I'm like, well, damn. Like I said, representation matters.
Yeah.
It's good that shows like this exist. That's all. Yeah. And honestly, the main takeaway from this show, the girl that plays Ms. Marvel, she is the best phase four casting that they have. Like, they killed her. Like, she owns this role. Like, the whole time through in the show, no matter what she's doing, you're into her with the journey. Like, you're going with the journey because she has so much energy about her. You know, I did find it funny, like, every other episode she gets a new boyfriend, but whatever. You know, like I said, it's a Marvel show. But yeah. All right, Eli, you're up.
Am I?
It's on you. Yeah, enough of this Disney Marvel shit, you know, and Afro Wesker. You know, give some good shit. Oh, not that.
Oh, what's that?
We won't talk about that.
Okay. Oh, we're going to Stranger Things. Oh,
we're going to Stranger Things. Okay. Oh, I forgot to tell you what we're talking about. My bad. I thought we were in sync. I thought I was Professor X mind jamming and shit.
You thought you were my girlfriend. I'm supposed to read your right? mind.
You're supposed to know what I'm thinking. You know?
All right. So we're going to go back to Stranger Things. There's been a lot of theories going around lately. So as people well know, except for Leroy, but he kind of knows. You got to know by now. So
through osmosis, through internet osmosis, yeah, I know.
Yes. So there's a big theory going around about Eddie Munson's character, the fan favorite of season 4 of Stranger Things, the metalhead. Yeah, yeah. The metalhead, Dungeons and Dragons player, outcast of the town. They have a theory about him that he might be alive. So I'm gonna have to break this down. So since the beginning of Stranger Things, they've been making references to Dungeons and Dragons. Yeah, the Demogorgon, the Upside Down, the Mind Flayer, and now Vecna, who is the newest villain. And he appears to be responsible for everything that's been going on in the show. Now, Vecna in Dungeons and Dragons is like a lich, zombie, wizard, king or whatever, and one of the most powerful villains in D&D lore. But he has
just to recap. So Vecna is not a name they just pulled out their ass.
No.
It's a thing. Okay. All right.
Yeah. So now in Dungeons and Dragons, Vecna is part of Dungeons and Dragons lore. In Dungeons and Dragons, Vecna has a lieutenant, a right-hand man named Cass the Red-Handed, I believe, or the Bloody-Handed. He's like a vampire warrior guy. And I guess how it goes in Dungeons and Dragons, he eventually betrays and kills Vecna. So this vampire warlord guy kills Vecna. He is a vampire. Now, how do you become a vampire? You have to be bitten by a vampire. Now, in episode 1 of season 4, they actually name drop this character, Cass, the Bloody Handed. And, you know, the kids are playing D&D, you know, and they say, oh, Vecna was killed by Cass. So they actually say that. Mike says it while they're playing a game in episode 1. Now, Eddie... spoilers, if you don't know by now, Eddie is killed by a bunch of vampire demon bats. And how do you become a vampire? You got to get bitten by a vampire.
Right.
Yeah, so Eddie was bitten by a bunch of vampire bats. Mm-hmm. Also, Eddie has, I guess they've noticed, Eddie has bat tattoos. So there's another clue there. And here's another thing. Now I'm going to get deep. We're going deep into metal now. You know, I know everyone loves metal right now because of the Metallica song, but I'm going deep. You know, yeah.
Eli, have you been out in your Metallica shirt lately and kids asked you, name your top three Stranger Things?
I haven't owned a Metallica shirt since like 1988. So, yeah. Don't get me started on Metallica. They're one of those bands. You know?
Okay.
But I'm going to get deep into metal now because, you know, this ain't no costume. This is a way of life. So in the show, Eddie holds up the album by Iron Maiden, Peace of Mind, in one scene. It's a great scene. He says, this is music, holds up Iron Maiden's album, Peace of Mind. On Peace of Mind, there's a song called The Trooper. The first line in the lyrics, you take my life, but I'll take yours too. That's what he says. It's a song about war also, Eddie, Iron Maiden, has a mascot, a zombie mascot that appears on all of the albums, all their album covers, all their artwork, all their shirts has this zombie dude. The name of that mascot is Eddie. So that's the first thing I thought of when the show came on. So Eddie is their mascot. you know, and he kind of looks like Eddie Munson from the show.
He does. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, Eddie on Iron Maiden, he's a zombie. You know, he appears in all the artwork. And, you know, this is from Somewhere in Time, 1986 album. There you go. There's Eddie Lives. So there's another clue that people have been, you know, thrown out there that Eddie lives. You know, Eddie talking about the mascot from Iron Maiden, that he's this zombie guy that never dies. More like Iron Maiden can never die, or, you know, ergo metal never dies, basically. You know, but Eddie lives, and because Eddie is a zombie that you cannot kill. You know, here's their Iron Maiden's album Live After Death. You see Eddie coming out of the ground. He cannot die. So that's another clue they've been saying. Also, there's an album. Iron Maiden has an album called Somewhere in Time, which is about time travel. It's not really about, it's kind of about time travel. There's a sci-fi element, but it's really about, you know, looking back on your life and wanting to change things and, or trying to change your future. It's like a reflective, you know, emotional song if you really get down to it. But there is some time travel elements to that song. Fans of Stranger Things are thinking that the next season is going to deal with time travel in some sort of way because of all the clocks and stuff that Vecna is controlling, and how they go backwards. So that's another reason why they think Eddie could come back in some fashion that way. But also, Eleven has life-giving powers because she brought Max back from the dead. Max is still in a coma, but she's not dead because Eleven was able to bring her back. So yeah, this is a huge theory going around that, you know, Eddie could still be alive. You know, that he could come back as some vampire warrior and kill Vecna, which would be kind of cool. You know, it's just, but as we know, it's just a theory. Fans, you know, want this guy to still be alive. A lot of people, he was the fan favorite. They all want him back. And I got to admit, I was a little pissed too when he died, you know, and I know that deaths of characters on show, they add to emotion and suspense and tension, and it just raises the stakes of the narrative, and I get that. But I was really into Eddie's story arc, you know, because he was like this outcast, this metalhead accused of murder, and he was on the run and the town was after him. You know, everyone thought he was like a devil worshiper, and because he listened to heavy metal and he played Dungeons and Dragons, they thought he had magical powers and all that shit. So I was really hoping to see how he would resolve all that. You know, and I think he would have been a great addition to the cast moving forward, you know, but then they killed him. And I'm like, well, that was fucking convenient. They took the easy way out because I was really hoping to see it. It would have been more interesting story to see him, you know, resolve all that, have a completed story arc, you know, but they killed him. And I'm like, well, whatever, you know, but he did go out like a true metalhead. He fought demon bats, you know, in another dimension with, you know, playing guitar, you know, he went out like a true metalhead, you know? So that was kind of cool. But yeah, I mean, as a fan of old, I mean, I was a metalhead back in the 80s. I was there for the, you know, I know what that satanic panic was like. You know, metalheads were treated like social pariahs. Everyone thought we were scumbags. You know, we were a bunch of misfits. We were, you know, lesser than. You know, they thought we were stupid and we were uneducated, and, you know, that metal was a low brow art form, you know, that didn't deserve respect or any credibility. So I know what that was like. I you know, I came up during that time. I was a very, I was always a defender of metal. Like, I always like defended it, you know, I was tired of always defending it, you know? So it would have been cool to see that this character that sort of represents that time, you know, resolve all that, you know, because, it, you know, I know everyone loves Eddie right now and he's hot. You got Doja Cat, you know, thinking he wants to bone him and shit, you know,
you know, but I briefly heard about that, but yeah.
Yeah. But we weren't getting that love back then, you know, you know, we you know, we thought everyone.
No Heather Locklear, you know, trying to chase.
No. You know, so yeah, I mean, it would have been cool to see Eddie sort of resolve that, but, you know, they killed him off. But yeah, so yeah, but that's the theory that's going on right now, that everyone thinks he's going to come back as some vampire Warrior and destroy Vecna, which would be kind of cool, but we'll see.
So. We'll see. Well, keep up alive. All right. So, like I said, we're going to briefly talk about this. We've been starting to ramp up our Black Panther 2 talk on this podcast, only because, like I said, I put a bit out there that I think it's going to be a thing. But we do want to talk about Daniel Kaluuya. Because Daniel Kaluuya has dropped out of Black Panther 2. You know, Ryan Coogler acted that you want to be in Black Panther 2. He told him, nope. You know, so I don't know why people think that he was going to be in this anyway, because next week he has his own movie coming out. So obviously there's going to be a scheduling conflict going on with that right now. So he can't be in two movies at one time, especially since he's starring in Nope, you know. But a lot of people are just using the fact that he's not going to be in Black Panther 2 as a reason to knock Black Panther 2. Eli, the sharks are swimming. The sharks smell blood. Yeah, like I said, there's been plot leaks that are coming out, which I don't even think they're really plot leaks. I think some asshole just wrote his own fan fiction and just put on a leak. It's like, from Deadline, from Hollywood Reporter, you know, and it just took off, and it's just what everybody thinks going on, you know. I don't think that's a thing. But that's what people are thinking. They're just using any excuse to kind of knock the movie right now, you know. And the fact that Daniel Kaluuya is not going to be in the movie, they use the old excuse to not, he's not going to be in the movie. The reason he's not in it because he read the script and it's going to suck. Like, what? First off, why would he be in the movie to begin with? It's like people don't even remember the movie, like remember the plot of the movie. First off, let's go back to what Daniel Kaluuya's character did in the movie. His name was Wakabi. Wakabi was the child of his friend. Wakabi committed treason. He snuck Killmonger into Wakanda, helped Killmonger overthrow the government, and help him almost try to kill T'Challa. Used his own army to help Killmonger carry out his plan. Got arrested by his own wife, thrown in jail and into the movie. So his whole storyline is wrapped up. Why would he even come back? And then his role wasn't even that big to begin with. So just like,
yeah,
why would he come back? So, but people, like I said, people just using that to just knock the movie. You know, at least wait for the trailer, then shit on the movie. Just, you know, one foot in front of the other one first, you know. But I don't use this as a reason to knock the movie. Like I said,
oh, yeah,
you got a movie coming out next.
Yeah, yeah. I've seen the Aztec Namor picture, whether or not that's
right
true or not.
That's what they're saying. He's gonna be NASDAQ or best with all the Atlantic. I'm hearing all kind of stuff. They're gonna find vibranium down there, and that's where they went. We don't know. Maybe that's where it's gonna be. I almost got kicked out of a Black Panther group myself because I have a theory that's saying that Namor might not be the villain of the movie. He might be the hero of the movie. Like, he might be the main character. Like, it might be about him, but we'll see. We'll see how the trailer goes. But yeah,
is that why you got kicked off of Facebook?
No, that I can't say, because I get kicked off every other platform. So, but yeah. We can just move on past that. Like I said, we don't skip the video game section. We're just going to move on past that. I ain't here to talk about that one anyway. But yeah, this is the Comic Book Bullies, where we talk about the comic books, and we're just going to jump into it. And Eli, I'll let you go first. I'll give you that honor.
Okay. Well, let's see. Should I start out? What should I start out with? Daredevil?
Daredevil. I'm so glad you read this book, because I didn't want to read it.
I thought you would read it.
I thought about it. I was like, do I want to read Daredevil? I don't know. But
okay, so this is the new Daredevil run, continuing off of Chip Zdarsky's run. And it's still Chip Zdarsky writing. So we pick up, you know, Wilson Fisk is supposedly dead. His son is now the new Kingpin. They think the Purple Children's memory thing wiped away or whatever. Now no one knows that Matt Murdock is Daredevil anymore and all that shit. It's back to status quo, basically, except that Kingpin's not around. Mm-hmm. So it starts out, there's some dude going around talking about, you know, the streets and crime and shit. You don't really know. You kind of think it's Matt at first, but it isn't. And then Matt disguises himself as Matt's brother and is talking to, what's his name? Eddie, the Wilson Fisk's son, the new, right, the son. He's talking to him.
In that last run, they kill Matt Murdock. Well, they kill Mike Murdock.
Yeah.
But Mike Murdock was pretending to be Matt Murdock. So yeah, they had a funeral for Matt Murdock.
Yeah. So he's pretending to be his brother, Matt, Mike. Is pretending to be Mike. and he's talking to Wilson Fisk's son, who's now the new Kingpin. And basically the son is like, yeah, my dad's really not dead. He just left. And he left me the organization, and, you know, but and he wants me to tell everybody he's dead so he can go into hiding. But I don't plan on being like the violent, you know, prick that my dad was and all that. So then Matt takes off his disguise as, I'm not Matt Murdock's brother. I'm actually Daredevil, and I'm here to make sure you don't fuck around and find out. So he beats the shit out of, you know, Wilson Fisk's son and all his cronies. Spider-Man shows up too. That's this scene.
You know, Spider-Man, yeah, I see shows Spider-Man up in the, okay, yeah.
Yeah, Peter Parker, Spider-Man shows up. They beat the shit out of everybody, and then they just go on a rampage, fucking cleaning up the streets, you know. And basically, he wants Matt Murdock is preparing to take off from Hell's Kitchen and go lead the Fist, which is that ninja group that's supposed to take out the Hand.
Okay.
Yeah, that he was saying.
Never heard him before, but okay.
Yeah, that's what him and Elektra said they were going to do at the end of that last run in Devil's Reign or whatever it was. At the end, it was like, we're gonna start the Fist, and finally they were prophesized to take out the Hand, and we're gonna start it. So, we cut to back to this guy who's narrating the book, and he can tell when something's about to happen. Like when violent shit's about to happen, he sees, okay, that dude's about to shoot somebody, and that happens, or that person's about to get hit by a car, and then that happens, you know. And then he sees Matt Murdock, and like, hey, Matt, remember me? And it turns out to be, I can't remember the guy's name, but it turns out to be a guy that they went to school, that Elektra, Foggy, and Matt, they all went to college with this guy.
Hey, oh, you remember me? That guy. Yeah, I know who you're talking about. I know you're talking about. I can't remember that guy's name, though.
Yeah, and he's like, oh, remember me? Oh, blah, 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 blah.
Like, but he's not like a thing or a supervillain. He's just a dude, well, like a lawyer or some shit.
Well, just he is a lawyer. Oh. And he's like, Matt Murdock was right about to get on the subway train when he said, hey, Matt, remember me? So they're talking, and then the train takes off, and then all of a sudden the train explodes.
Hmm.
And the guy tells Matt, like, yeah, you were about to get on that train, but, you know, I stopped you from getting on that train. So basically, I'm your guardian angel. And then it cuts to Matt Murdock. He's like confessing. He's like in a confessional booth. And then he talks about how he's never feared anything. He's supposed to be the man without fear, but he does fear something. He has the fear of God. And that's where it ends. So they're bringing in this like Christian angel from the Bible element to the story, which normally I would be like, oh, Jesus Christ. But I'm like, if you're going to like take the Bible as a book of mythology, okay, then like Spawn. You know,
right? I mean, Spawn can get away with that. The thing is, anytime Marvel like writers try to do that, Marvel shut that shit down quick. For instance, Ghost Rider's original run in the 70s ended because they wanted him to fight Jesus. And they're like, no, that's not gonna happen.
Yeah, but I just bringing that element in there, that like, because Matt Murdock he's a Catholic, right? He's always going to church, and his mom's a nun and all this shit, and you know, so like they don't. Like bringing that sort of theology, Christian theology, into the narrative
it's always been there. It's always been there. Like, for instance, like Daredevil lives in Hell's Kitchen.
Hell, yeah, and he dresses up as a devil. And
the devil, yeah.
But he's a Catholic, so like, but bringing in the
devil is an angel.
Yeah. So, but bringing in like an actual character from the Bible.
Right,
you know, into Hell's Kitchen.
I think it's a swerve.
Bringing it to the street level, Hell's Kitchen shit. Mm-hmm. I'm like, okay, that.
I think it's a swerve. Yeah. I think it's Ralph Boner.
Yeah, he's not an angel.
He's not an angel. He's some, because they always do this with Daredevil. It's always like, oh, it's the chosen baby, the Messiah, but it's really just Mysterio gassing him some shit. It's always something like that, you know.
Yeah, well, we'll see. Anyway, yeah. it was kind of interesting because the whole time he's in a confessional booth,
you know. Yeah,
but he is trying to have a second calling. Like, he feels like this is a second calling to him, You know, like I'm through being the ninja on the streets, just fighting crime. I need to, you know, do something more. Me and Elektra, or we're gonna finally put a stop to the hand, and that's what they're doing. And then we get a bonus story at the end, like a 10-pager about Elektra and Stick, and they, you know, they're on their, they're basically preparing their the fist
Stick
base.
Dead. Stick is dead, isn't he? It's comics. Never mind. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Everybody's dead. Elektra's dead. How many times Elektra died?
That's true. But Frank Miller killed a dude back in the '80s. But it's like, well, fuck it. It doesn't matter. Yeah. Yes.
But they're on this island, and they're getting ready to prepare the base for the fist or whatever. And then a bunch of Russian agents show up, and they kick their asses. And you know, then they have a philosophical discussion about you know, whipping ass. You know.
Cool.
So anyway, I thought it was pretty cool. So I'm gonna check out the next issue. So I'll give it a 4.
Okay. All right. So next book I'm going to do is X-Men: The Hellfire Gala.
I almost got this. I almost bought it just to like check in, but then I saw the price and I'm like, fuck.
I honestly went back. I saw the price. I'm like, fuck no. Went back and I was like, I need one more book to review. Like, I want to review this shit.
$8. I could buy $8.
Yeah, man. I did it. It was you got your money's worth for like 60 some pages. But so this is a meaty, girthy book. But like I said, I'm gonna speed through this fast possible. I'm gonna trim the fat and just get to the main part of what's going on. Cause like I said, it's the Hellfire Gala. But people don't know what the Hellfire Gala is. Okay, so everybody knows what the Met Gala is, like with the Kardashians and everybody shows up, you know, for Hollywood. Well, the X-Men do the same thing, where you have to get dressed up and you wear your finest outfit and they just throw a party. That's it. And the outfits are designed by like some kind of high-end or like the best designers in comics. And they really spend a whole lot of time just showing off the design, like Dr. Doom design. Like we'll show you. I'll show you.
Anyway, let's get to it. Victor Versace.
Right. Let's get to it. So the story starts up, but it's actually a story. It's not just like a bunch of shit going on. But anyway, we get to the Summers, Jean Grey and Cyclops. And they said what happened in the gala last year. And they basically talking about, we're going to leave the Quiet Council and let's join the X-Men. You know, are we making the right decision? Yeah, we're making the right decision. Cut to this year. And it was like, yeah, we fucked up. we shouldn't have quit the Quiet Council because now we got problems. And they go from there. And they bang. So yeah, I don't know why. Anyway, cut to Krakoa. Bishop is doing a training session right now, and then Professor X calls him. He tells him, "You got to cut the training session short. Come to the Quiet Council. I need you right now. Call the meeting. Serious shit going down." And Bishop's like, "Why don't you just download information of what you're trying to tell me so we can speed the shit up?" And he downloads. He like, "Oh shit, that's what's going on. Meeting's over. Cancel. I got to take care of some shit." And basically, what's going on is that, yeah, the Daily Bugle has leaked the secret. The entire planet knows that the X-Men knows how to resurrect people. And matter of fact, they did an interview with Cyclops. So it's not like hearsay. He told them what they did. You know, and Emma's just like, oh, this how you gonna fuck me? You know, while she's getting ready for the gala, because this is a day before the gala. So basically, the rest of the Marvel Universe knows, like the Avengers, the Fantastic Four, they were actually gonna cancel the Met Gala. I mean, X Gala, Hellfire Gala, whatever the fuck this shit is. They were going to cancel. When they heard that shit, they're like, and Tony's just like, oh shit, get my suit ready. I got to go to this shit. I got to see what's going on. I got to have a conversation with them. So they go. I dropped the X-Men book, so I didn't catch on what the fuck was going on with this one. But they find out who Dr. Stasis was. Dr. Stasis was like the big bad of the X-Men main book. Dr. Stasis is Mr. Sinister.
Oh.
But the real Mr. Sinister, the one on Krakoa, is clones, all of them, every single one of them.
That makes sense because he was, yeah. Because that was when I was reading Hellions.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So every Mr. Sinister clone on Krakoa is the real one is working for the enemy, you know. And while they're getting ready for the gala, and not only that, Moira MacTaggert is there. She's with them now. She's with the bad guys. So she left her because Krakoa kicked her out, you know, and chopped her arm off, you know. So she's like, oh, I got a plan for them. So she's telling them all the secrets, and she basically saying, I'm going to the gala too, but she can't go to the gala looking like Moira MacTaggert, they kill her on sight. So going back to what they did, she kidnapped Mary Jane Watson because Mary Jane has an invitation to the gala because she's like one of their ambassadors and shit like that. So she took her own arm off, wrapped her arm around Mary Jane Watson to like control her. And she's like, I'm going to wear her like a meat puppet. I don't really know the whole science behind it. But anyway, that's how she's going to get into the gala. It's Mary Jane's going to be her eyes and ears in the gala. She's going to be basically controlling her. And that's what's going on with that. So let's just speed up past this more crying council bullshit. Don't care. Sink, don't care. And then we cut to Emma Frost. And Emma Frost basically, you know, just letting everybody in the gala. She's like, okay, the gala's going to start. And she, the first person she brings in, Mary Jane Watson. Mary Jane Watson's going to be like the main person controlling the gala, you know. And then she's like, but we're not going to talk about that secret that just came out. We're just going to just get to the meat of it, you know. And then Cyclops is basically trying to tell her, like, look, Emma, we got to talk. You're like, fuck you. I want to talk to you. You just let the whole secret out the day before the party I'm throwing, you know. And then that's when a guy comes in. He's like, oh, can I cut in? And she's like, oh, hey, I've been waiting for you to come. And it's John Hamm from Mad Men. Yeah. So he's there. So Emma Frost, you know, is just like, oh, yes, I've been waiting for you to come here. And then she just takes off, starts dancing. She's like, oh, shit, well, we ain't going to talk to her tonight, you know. And that's when the shit pops off. So then you got Clea, you know, who's the new Doctor Strange, and she wants to talk to Emma Frost. And she's just like, look, I got something I got to tell you. Doctor Strange died. So Emma's like, yeah. You want me to bring him back to life? We don't bring back nobody back to life but mutants. Since Doctor Strange's not a mutant, well, I'm not bringing him back. So, and everybody's been killing me the whole day. They want to bring John Lennon back. They want to bring Tupac back. No, I'm not bringing any of those people back. They're not a mutant. They're not coming back. Plus, you probably make a better source of supreme than him anyway. I mean, he's dead. You're alive. So that's kind of giving you a leg up on him right now anyway. So bye. So she leaves, talks to Spider-Man, you know, just like have fun. So Spider-Man sees Mary Jane. He's like, Mary Jane, what you doing here? And Mary Jane just says, hello, Spider-Man. I'm here because my aunt is a part of Krakoan and I am an ambassador. You have a nice day, Spider-Man. And Spider-Man, like, people like, wait, what the fuck? Like, they not on good terms, but at the same time, your ex-wife don't just blow you off like that, like she never met you before, you know. Meanwhile, Cypher did catch on to that shit, but we're going to come back to that. Next, we would go to Dr. Doom. We're going to call him Dr. Drip, because look at this outfit he got on. We're going to show him in a second. You know, that shit is clean. That didn't even just his outfit, just his outfit from now on, you know. And Spider-Man just says a little joke to him, like he always joking and shit like that. Hey, Dr. Doom, which mean you think they're going to bring back? You think they're going to bring back David Bowie or Prince? He's like, get the fuck out of my face. He's like, I'm leaving, you know. And then Dr. Doom thinks to himself, David Bowie a mutant? You know, so he doesn't know if it's true or not. So yeah, we're gonna cut past this. Emma Frost and Firestorm getting some bullshit. Don't care. Captain America tells story how Rogue beat his ass. Don't care.
Oh shit, Forge. There's Forge.
We're coming back to Forge.
Forge drink, man. Why are they letting? Yeah, don't give Forge a drink, man. He'll fuck the whole place up, man. Don't party with the native, man. The natives will sab out on you.
They brought Forge to the party, but Forge is here for a reason.
He's gonna fuck y'all up, man.
Forge is here. So yeah, so the Five shows up to the party, even though they're supposed to be protected. But anyway, the Fives are here. They want a party, you know. And Proteus, Mary Jane waves at Proteus, and she's like, hey, Proteus, well, let's go talk. Let's go somewhere and talk for a second, you know, because Proteus is Moira MacTaggert's son. So that's when he tells her. I mean, he didn't know she was even alive. So when he takes her thing off and she basically turns into Moira MacTaggert, he's like, Mom, the hell? You alive? Yeah, I've been alive the whole time. And she tells him everything about what's going on. So that's when Tony Stark shows up. Tony Stark does his old Tony Stark bullshit. Oh, this is actually pretty cool. I gotta watch this. Yeah. Tony sees Reed and he just talks to Reed. He's like, Reed, hey, did you know about the X-Men? Could they resurrect themselves? He's like, no. Oh, really? You should have didn't like mind wipe you or some shit like that? He's like, no. I'm like, okay, cool. Like, wait, what'd you say? He's like, yeah, the X-Men. Let me tell you about what the X-Men did. Charles Magneto last year mind wiped me, but they mind wiped me just enough to let them know they did it. They're fucked up. They're doing some crazy shit right now. Tony, like, I didn't know about any of this shit. Like, okay, yeah. So sits down with Emma, talks to Emma. He's like, Emma, did you know about the shit they were doing? You know, and they basically just talk and do their little repartee, stuff like that. Basically, Tony's trying to hit on her like he always does, but she doesn't even recognize him because he only hits on her in his Iron Man suit. So she don't even know what Tony Stark looks like, you know. This thing right here, you can't see it, but the artist was having a little bit too much fun with Emma's suit right there, but we're going to keep going. Cut to it. Get to the point. We got Spider-Man.
Hey, eating. Hey, go back.
Hey, who?
Go
what,
back.
What?
That's
what?
Eddie from Iron Maiden. That's the Eddie.
Oh, is that what that is?
Is that Brian?
That's hey, Eddie from Iron Maiden. He says,
I'm just hallucinating, right? Eddie, is that Brian Posehn? It is.
Yes. Yes.
And Brian Posehn's a metalhead. He likes metal. So yeah, he's chilling with Eddie, the Eddie mascot from Iron Maiden.
The fuck? Yeah, because Cypher's talking to Deadpool, and Deadpool's like, I'm mad at both of them. He's like, are you talking about Posehn or Spidey? He like both of them. So I didn't know who Posehn was. I didn't recognize the guy or Eddie. I'm like, why is Frankenstein here? You know, that's what I'm thinking the whole time.
And that's the Trooper. That's Trooper Eddie from the song that I talked about during, you know, the Stranger Things bit. You know, you take my life, I'll take yours too. Yeah, I'll pull it up. I'll pull it. You keep talking.
I'm glad you're on this podcast because I didn't know what the hell that was. But anyway, Cypher's talking to Spider-Man. He's talking to Peter. He's like, hey, Spider-Man, one of my superpowers is reading language, right? So I read your body language with that redhead that you walk past. They're like, what redhead? I don't know no redhead. There's like 1,000 redheads at this party. It's the X-Men. They love redheads. You're like, you know what redhead I'm talking about. They're like, oh, yeah, that redhead. So you can't play me offline. And then Cypher just like, yeah, that redhead over there. She's tapping on the glass saying SOS. She's about to come rescue her right now. Like, oh, really? So Spider-Man just goes to work, you know. And basically, it's Moria dressed as Mary Jane telling him all kind of fucked up shit. Like, yeah, I never loved you. You were just creation. I was just used you to better mankind. You're just a tool for the five. You're just useless. You're not even as dangerous as you used to be before. He's like, yeah, I see what you're trying to do. But you know what? I'm not going to let you go, me, you know. And since Spider-Man just kicked the shit out of him, he's like, leave my ex-wife alone. They're like, Spider-Man, what the fuck wrong with you? You know, and that's when, you know, so basically Spider-Man started a fight at the party, you know. So that's when the fire kicks in because Proteus is one of the five. And Emma Frost is like, damn, you can't take Spider-Man nowhere. You know, just looking at him. So Proteus and Spider-Man are fighting. And that's when the five shows up. And the five's just like, okay, he's fighting one of us. We got to go to work. So are we fighting Spider-Man or are we fighting a supermodel? Because Gold Balls is just like, because if I got to fight supermodel, I'm not fighting a supermodel, you know. And then that's when Moria / Mary Jane just leaves. She's like, I'm going to leave you to yourself because you're useless. And as Wolverine shows up, he's like, yeah, something ain't right here. He was like, you might want to leave. No, he knows it's Moria. He knows it's Moria right now. He's like, Moria, I've been looking for you for a while. I'm chasing your ass all over the world. And that's when Moria's just like, you don't want to do that. And then she turns back into Mary Jane real quick. She's like, she's got me hostage. And she just leaves. And that's it. And Spider-Man's getting ready to take Mary Jane. Wolverine's like, sit your ass down, Spider-Man. You're going to do something to get her killed. You know. So then she walks to the gate. And oh, and he tells your boy, Grey Crow. He tells Grey Crow, track him. Yeah. So Grey Crow is just like, I got him. Don't worry about it. When I find out where they're going, I'll let you know. And Spider-Man and Wolverine chase after him on, you know, Grey Crow's thing. So we finally know another book.
He's just wearing a tux, right?
Yeah, he's just wearing a tux. He's not all dripped out, swagged out, nothing like that.
He ain't got no choker on or no fucking feather or no shit.
Nothing like that. You know, he might be wearing Versace. You don't know. You know. Then Giant Hand just asks, you know, Emma Frost, you want to, now can we dance? You're like, yeah, we dance. And then it turns out it's really Cyclops. You know, Jean Grey was mind controlling her, making her think of Cyclops while she's dancing with John Hamm. And Cyclops is like, oh, yeah, yeah, John Hamm is on her hall pass list. So it's cool, you know. But Emma Frost is basically she's basically dumping all the information that she learned from the Quiet Council to Cyclops. Magneto and Charles out of control. Morgan McTaggart is alive. They mind wipe Professor X. They mind wipe Mr. Fantastic. Mr. Sinister is on the bad guys team. So she's just telling all this. And Mr. Sinister's at the party. You know, they're like, what the fuck? You know, so they're like, why don't we kill this guy right now? Like, nah, we can't do that. We got to find out what they're doing. You know, so and then Emma and Cyclops is flirting the whole time while his wife is dancing with her hall pass, you know. And yeah, basically, Memoria is basically out of control. She's been alive for a millennium. Every single thing the X-Men have done, she's been controlling. She control and all the shit like that. So yeah, it's going on. So they part ways, and that's it. She's like, I'll tell you later on what happened. Oh, and then they announced the X-Men. But let's go to it. Here's the new X-Men. So the new X-Men are boom.
Wanda. Magic.
They didn't add Wanda to the team. I don't know why they didn't add Wanda to the team. Maybe she's on the team and they did.
Blinged out and shit.
Yeah, but Wanda's like was up for election, but they didn't elect her or some shit. But anyway, you got Firestar. Let's do that. Firestar and Iceman, you know, from Spider-Man and Amazing Friends. So they're both on the team together. Iceman was like, I'll join the X-Men if you join Firestar. So that's it. Firestar is one of the original members of the OG Hellions back in the 80s. So that's how she knows Emma Frost. Magic, your boy Forge, he's a member.
My boy.
Havoc is on the team.
All
right. And Sync, Cyclops, and Jean Grey. So those are the new X-Men. So the old X-Men roster that we saw, we've been reading, they're gone. This is the new roster. So
he's writing that.
Same guy, Jerry Duggan.
Oh, okay.
You know. Meanwhile, Professor X is looking at Forge like, what the fuck, Forge? Don't I have you doing something for me? You're like, no, don't worry. I'm gonna do my thing, the thing you put me on. And if it gets in the way of me being an X-Men, I just quit the X-Men. You're like, okay, cool. That's all right. You know. And Tony Stark goes to Firestar because Firestar used to be an Avenger. He's like, congratulations, Firestar. If the X-Men do some wild shit, remember your Avenger card still works, right? You know, drop me a dime, you know. So Tony has a spy on the team, you know. Meanwhile, let's cut to the end. Yeah, this. So we cut to Maureen McTaggart. We don't know what happened afterwards, but she has blood on her hands. And she has a hand. So yeah, so we don't know where the fuck that came from. And she's washing her hands. And she's just like, I came to meet you. I can't talk to you guys. He like, first off, how do you know so much about us? And the person she's talking to is Druig, the Eternals. And they try to kill on the spot. She's like, you don't want to kill me because I got information. I got information on 5 deviants you can take care of. And she names the 5. She's like, if you kill any one of them, the X-Men can't resurrect themselves. So there you go. Have at it. Kill these guys. The end. Or to be continued in X or Judgment or whatever the fuck.
Who the fuck is right she? Who is she?
Who?
Moria.
Does
she have like powers again or what the fuck happened?
No. She's just human. She's human. I can't took her powers.
Well, how's she doing all that shit?
Oh, because she just lived so long, she just knows how to do that.
Oh, okay. I thought she was gonna be like fucking Mystique or some shit.
No. She's just she's science, all that shit. Yeah, she knows science. Yeah.
Well, there you go. There's Eddie from
Damn. Okay. Yeah.
That's Trooper Eddie. So the song The Trooper, that's what that is. So that's what that referred to.
I had no idea who that guy was you were talking about. When you showed me this, I mean, when I read the book, I was just like, why is there a zombie here? But yeah, that makes
Brian
sense.
Brian Posehn is hanging with Brian Posehn, who's he's a big metalhead too.
Oh, I skipped over a panel. Like the head guy of Marvel, like CC Sabathia, whatever like that. He shows up in the book also. And one of the X-Men asks him, can I get my own book? You know, Kevin Feige showed up in the last one. No.
All right.
That was a scam. Anyway, he probably just stole my Netflix account again. So, yeah. All right. So what you got next? That was long, but none of the rest of the books are that long. But yeah.
I will do New Mutants, number 27.
Were they at the gala?
Not this one. No, they're still in limbo, man. This is that whole limbo storyline that's still going on.
Okay, cool.
Where so Ileana, aka Magic, she's turning over limbo to Madeline Pryor, but then the demons attacked and a bunch of shit happened, and so then her soul sword got broken, and now they're all, it's like Wolfsbane and Danny Moonstar, like, you know, they're fighting the Red King and shit. But there's like it's a simple storyline. It's just the way it's being told, I think, is interesting. There's parallels to, there's all these Alice in Wonderland references, and she meets her younger self. Last issue, she met old woman Ileana. She met her older self. And this one, she meets herself as a child. Back when Ileana was stuck in limbo and figuring things out, doing magic, figuring out her magic and stuff. So, you know, so we got a glimpse into her future. Now we get a glimpse into her past, and all these Alice in Wonderland references. It's simple, but you know, it's interesting with the whole, the way they're breaking up. It's creatively told. You know, the storyline, there's not much story going on, but it's just the creative way they're telling it is what's making this book. So I'll give it a 3 out of 5. They basically face off with the Red King, this demon guy who instead of the Red Queen from, you know, Alice in Wonderland, he's the Red King, and they fight him. And, you know, so this is, I think there's like one more in this story arc about Limbo. Because yes, as now that you've seen, magic is going to be on the X-Men. So.
Right. So she got other shit to do. So yeah.
So I'll give it a 3 out of 5. It's fine. It's just a cool way of telling the story, you know, and the different art styles, and you get to see some panels that are like this old style fairy tale sort of art, you know, and then you get that it cuts back to the comic art, and it's just pretty cool visually. So.
Cool. Okay. Sticking with X-Men and technically Avengers, we're going to stick with the big summer blockbuster of the year. What is this? X? Okay. Avengers, X-Men, Eternals. For people who don't know what that means. So that's what X. It's just X, you know. Like it used to be AVX. So like basically that's what the story is. So this isn't the actual story. It's another prelude to the story, even though I read Road to X, Judgment of X, whatever of X, this is X, more X. So yeah.
Body spray X.
Body spray X, right. I don't know why they didn't do tie-in with that, but yeah, that's what's going on with the story. So I'm gonna just fly through the story as much as possible. Like I said, just another preview, just long bunch of shit that I don't care about. Anyway, so the machine is talking, and the machine is Earth. It's like Earth. Yeah. So the Eternals can talk to Earth, and they're just talking like everything's cool. The Iron Man cooked everybody waffles or some shit, you know. Even the X-Men just chilling out, having fun, you know, it's like that. And Druig. So Druig is now Eternal Prime. Last time I read the Eternals comics, like last year sometime, Thanos was Eternal Prime. But something happened where I didn't want to pay attention. So now he runs the Eternals. And basically, he just talking to Domo, NX Domo. If you were me, how would you kill all the mutants? And Domo's just like, let me think. Oh, yeah, I got away. Matter of fact, I already got an idea right now how to kill all the mutants. A bomb. Just blow them up. Just be done with it. Take this big-ass bomb, put it underneath Krakoa, and blow it up. And matter of fact, the bomb is so generic that they can't even trace it back to us. Everybody's going to wonder who killed the mutants. Nobody will know, you know. And like I said, we just kill the mutants on Earth, so the mutants in Mars, we don't care about them. But if it comes to Earth, then we'll deal with them. You know, so that's the thing. So... And he's like, man, that's a good ass plan. That's the plan that I would have came up with, you know. So anyway, build a bomb. We'll kill the mutants by afternoon, and we'll get drinks later on. So be done with that. Skip, 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 skip. Back here. Okay.
Sounds like a great book.
Right. Bunch of shit that didn't happen, you know. So anyway, Druig is still spying on the X-Men, so because he has a spy on Krakoa that they don't know about. You know, he's like, that's so lively and healthy. Can we please do something about that? Can we kill these guys? You know, and Domo's like, don't worry, I'm almost done with the bomb. But can I ask you a question, Druig? Why do you want to commit genocide? I mean, I'm going to build a bomb for you anyway. I'm just curious, you know. Well, yeah, I'll tell you why. Because first off, the Deviants, every superhero and supervillain on the planet has a Deviant strain in them, but the mutants are more concentrated strain. Matter of fact, the mutants are deviants. They just call them by a different name. So if the mutants are out of control this much, we have to get rid of them. Matter of fact, they have mutants on Mars. The deviant strain is out of control. So if I'm going to be the new ruler of the Eternals, that's the first thing I got to do. And the thing is, Druig in his head really saying, I don't really give a shit about the X-Men. I'm only doing this shit because 1,000 years or 2,000 years from now, when they remember my name as the ruler of the Eternals, this is what I did. So it basically immortalized his rule. And they build a bomb and they drop it in the ocean, you know, right underneath Krakoa. It's like, well, that's done. Let's get some drinks. Cool. But then they start freaking out because they're violating one of the three rules of the Eternals. The three rules of the Eternals is protect the machine, protect people, kill deviants. You know, and basically when it means protect the machine, it means protect Earth. You know, so basically, I cut it in. They can't kill Krakoa. They can't blow Krakoa because Krakoa technically is part of the machine. Krakoa is sentient. So they literally physically can't attack Krakoa. Otherwise, it will kill them. So they realize, okay, so we can't build a bond to blow up the X-Men. What do we need to do? He's like, don't worry, I got a plan. If you want to commit Jewish genocide, ask the expert. And they go to Uranus, not Uranus. And this is Thanos's granddad. No, Thanos's uncle or somebody, some shit like that. Anyway, the guy that makes Thanos look like shit is this guy. You know, he like, well, if you want to kill somebody, you should just came to me. To be continued. That's the book. So yeah, let's just cut to the end of it. The thing I'm mad at, I mean, I'm enjoying the concept of the storyline, but I'm sick of all these preludes. I feel like they're ripping me off. Road to X, Journey to X. Here comes the X. Give me the X. I want the X. I'm ready for it.
X is coming.
Right. My body is ready. Give it to me. Yeah. Okay. But yeah, what did you got next?
My last book I'm doing is Ninja Turtles, The Armageddon Game, number one.
Okay, so this isn't tied to the game?
No, this is, I guess, no, this is tied to the greater IDW lore that's going on, the IDW
book. Oh, okay, I don't know why I thought this was part of the video game. I thought you were like a video game tie-in.
Oh, no. no, this, I had to like, you know, I kind of had to like go back and, you know, research a little bit about what was exactly was happening, because it just kind of drops you right in. But I get this is like a big event that's coming up in the new Ninja Turtle comics. So basically we have Shredder, who is now resurrected a third time. He's died a few times, you know, throughout, you know, the series. This is his third time being resurrected, and now he's trying to redeem himself. He has been the evil warlord. He has been the crime boss of the Foot. And, you know, then he went to hell where he, you know, battled his past demons. And now his concubine, which I can't remember her name now. Anyways, he has like a concubine who has superpowers, like magical powers. She resurrects him. And they find out that the Rat King is trying to take over the world. He's banding together, teaming up with Krang, Leatherhead Krang. So Krang is now inside the mutant crocodile Leatherhead. Okay. I thought that was kind of cool. So Leatherhead Krang, Baxter Stockman, and somebody else. Who was it? I think it's just those three, right? Yeah, Leatherhead, Krang, and Baxter Stockman. No. Rat King. So they're basically trying to, you know, take over the world. But Krang and this team is like super hard to beat. So what the magic woman says to Shredder, says we can go in. Basically what happened in an older story, Splinter killed Shredder was he was able to look into his past and see a weakness, a past weakness. And that's how he exploited and ended up killing Shredder back in an older storyline. So we're going to do the same thing. We're going to go into the memories of Krang and basically figure out how to beat him. So that's what they do. The majority of this book takes place in space. They go back into Krang's memory and they recall a time where he was back in space. The Utroms, the TCRI aliens, you know, were fighting the Supreme Squadron? No, the Nova Squadron, I believe, or the Squadron Nova or something. And that's when it dawned on me. You know how the Ninja Turtles have always been inspired by, like, Daredevil? You know?
Right.
They're like a parody of Daredevil. Well, this all that space shit started reminding me of, like, Guardians of the Galaxy and like Thanos. One dude actually looked like Thanos. like this rope. Big,
they were doing that space shit even back in the '80s, though. Like, oh yeah, Ultrons,
yeah, the Fugitoid and all that shit, and Krang right, and yeah. the TCRI and the Triceratons, those dinosaur dudes and shit.
Right.
But you know, this it's basically a big giant space battle, and you know, it reminded me of like some Guardians or Thanos shit, and but basically, when Krang will retreat from battle when backup arrives. So, and he fears this Squadron Nova or the Nova Squadron again, like the Nova Corps. You know what I mean?
Right.
That's what it reminded me of too. So, he basically they figure out that Krang fears the Nova Corps or the Nova Squadron or whatever. So they're gonna go try to contact the Nova Squadron and get them on their team to fight the Rat King and Krang and, you know, Baxter Stockman. So that's basically where it ends on that. And you know, it was just, you know, being that I've been into the Ninja Turtle shit lately because I've been playing the game, you know.
Right.
So I thought this was kind of fun, you know. Going into like Shredder's past was interesting. I had no idea that, you know, because I haven't really read any. I read a little bit of the IDW stuff, you know, but I dropped off it. So I have really, and then I'd read a little bit of the Shredder Went in Hell shit, the Shredder in Hell series, but I never finished it. But so it was kind of interesting to seeing, you know, where he is now. He's trying to redeem himself. He's trying to make, you know, he's going to try and befriend the Ninja Turtles this time. You know, so I don't know. I thought it was kind of fun, and I'll give it a 4 out of 5. Good old Ninja Turtles.
Nice. Okay. All right. Last book I got is going to be Superman, Son of Kal-El.
Okay, I read this.
Yeah, Superman, Son of Kal-El, number 13, and this is a special issue, I guess. This is a maybe collector's item issue. I don't know. Maybe it is or not. Maybe. It depends on your definition of it. The reason, because it's the DC like in universe debut of Dreamer.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So for those who don't know, I just started. This is the story. We'll get to it. yeah. So anyway, let me keep up with the story. Basically, the last issue that they went to the Capitol and they fought the senator turned into a tentacle monster. And while they were fighting the tentacle monster, Jay's mask came off and basically got him on camera. Now everybody else identity. His identity is out there. You know, he's no longer the truth. He's Jay McNamara. You know, Gamoran citizen. You know, somebody even asked, like, y'all worried about this story? And the senator turned into a giant tentacle monster? Like, should we be more worried about that? But nah, Fox News want to talk about this shit, you know. So they like this propaganda, this wake up sheeple, you know. And basically it's like, okay, we need to go, so we need to hide. And John's just like, well, I can take you to Saturn if you want. You're like, yeah, except I can't breathe in space. You're like, oh yeah, that's right. Well, you go with my grandparents. No, because Batman said I'm not allowed there. I'm like, damn, okay. I got a place that I know nobody can get you there. Okay. Make sure you pack warm. So they fly to the Fortress of Solitude, you know, basically saying, and Jace is like, well, why is it more people don't attack the Fortress of Solitude? He was like, well, first off, my dad built it so it doesn't show up on any radar. It has a giant key that weighs like 100 tons. So people just can't pick it up, you know? So yeah. So you gotta be Superman strength in order to even get here or even to find it. So they go inside the door and boom, there you go. It's Dreamer. So this is Dreamer. Now, gotta explain who Dreamer is real quick, since the whole story is pretty much about Dreamer. Now, for those who don't know, Dreamer debuted on the CW. Yeah, she was on the Supergirl show. You know, I do feel like DC is maybe a week or maybe 2 weeks behind debuting Dreamer, because Dreamer is LGBT. She may be the first trans superhero. Most people don't know that the actress is trans on the show, you know. So this thing. So the thing about interesting about Dreamer is that basically, since she's in this DC universe now, she's technically what the trope call a canon immigrant. We just saw another cameo immigrant in the last Marvel book we just read, which is Firestar. Basically, what that means when a character is created outside of continuity and then placed later on in the continuity, like Harley Quinn, Phil Coulson from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., like Jimmy Olsen. Jimmy Olsen didn't debut in the comics. He came from the radio show and later put in the comics also. So Dreamer's in there now. So Dreamer is a member of the DC Universe. She's canon. So back to the story. Okay. So anyway, they ask, okay, how the hell did you get into? The name of the story is Dreams and Nightmares. So they named it after a Meek Mill album, but whatever. Superman, you know, John's looking like, how the hell did you get here? Like, first off, this is the Fortress of Solitude. You can't get in. That's the whole point of being a Fortress of Solitude. He was like, okay, yeah. So your dad, you know, has like this intergalactic zoo, but he went around the universe like saving animals and put them here to be take care of. I snuck to one of the dreams. Like, what? Yeah, so that's how I got in here. Okay, so why are you here? He like, because I got to show you something. And we cut to a week later, and it's the Joker strung up, shot, you know, hung up on a building. And, you know, the Bat family looking at him like, damn, is that real? Like, yep, that's him. No, that's the Joker. He's dead, you know. And that's when President Bendis is like, okay, operate phase 2, order 66, or whatever the fuck he says, you know. So they go to work, and they drop down Gas Giant, with a giant ha-ha on his head, and he basically sprays the entire city with Joker gas. So everybody is Jokerized. Damian, Nightwing, everybody. So the Justice League goes into action, but they get there, it's too late. But Superman, you know, John sucks up all the air, which is some Superman shit that Superman always does. And he's like, I'm gonna take all the gas of space while y'all take care of it. But they get there, everybody in Gotham is dead, you know. And that's when, you know, President Bendix and his army gets there and they go to work and Superman, you know, blows the air out, you know, like puff, puff, pass, blows the air, you know, smoke into space. But he can hear with a super hearing that the Justice League's in trouble. So he tries to fly back down. But while he flies down, he gets weak, you know, so he just crashes to the ground like the Justice League dead. You probably can't see it, but Hal Jordan's finger was cut off, you know, to get the ring off his hand. He just crashed the ground. It's like, what the hell? Why are you weak? And Bendis is just like, you feel kind of weak, don't you? He's like, what you do to me? He's like, yeah, that Joker gas, we laced with kryptonite. And they captured Batman. And he's just like, so you know what? You don't look too good, Superman. You don't look like you're faster than a speeding bullet right now. So he put a gun to Batman's head, boom, blows Batman's head off. Dead. So, yeah, so that's the thing. So they're like, what the hell did you just show me? And basically telling him what I showed you was the future. I have my dream powers can see the future. This is a possible future that may happen a week from now. And I got to show you this because if I don't, the Justice League dies next week. I'm like, oh shit. So yeah. So that's that. What else happens at the end? Something else big happens. Something big happens. Oh yeah. This happens. Since they find out that Jay Nakamura is the truth and he's a Gamoran citizen, that's when he's like, bring me the dissident one. To attack Superman. And like, you sure you want to do that? Like, yes, get her. And it turns out the dissident one is Jay's mom. They're going to turn her into one of those crazy ass supervillains. They're going to basically use it to attack Superman. The end.
Oh, that's his mom.
That's his mom, yeah.
Oh, for some reason, I thought that was Lois.
No.
I thought that was Lois. I was like, oh, shit. Okay, well, then that's not as cool.
Right. It's still pretty cool. You know,
that's still pretty cool, but yeah, I was like, oh, shit, they got Lois. Lois is going to fuck all.
Right, because you know they can't do it to Lois because they can't undo it to Lois, but his mom, yeah, they can fuck her up. Just whatever, you know. Yeah. Shoot, any more books? Or?
No, I'm booked out.
Booked out. Okay, yeah. So, yeah, we got all the books we got. Like I said, listen as long, different, like, share, subscribe. Does next week come out or a week after next? I don't know. I lost track.
And Comic-Con, we're gonna have a bunch of like
Comic-Con drop. Whatever happens, yeah, Comic-Con is gonna go nuts. Marvel will be there. Marvel has already planned out their panel of what they're going to announce. So we don't know what Marvel's gonna announce, but it's gonna be big shit. So we're gonna pick
apart. We're all gonna be nerdgasming all of like
It's gonna be everywhere. I already know what's gonna happen. Like, I'm going to be tagged 100 times from people. Oh, have you seen this? Have you seen this? Yes, I've seen it. Don't tag me. I've already seen it. I'll probably be watching shit on Twitch. So yes, and watch, they tag me like 3 days after the shit. You know. but yeah. Follow us next week. We're gonna have some big shit coming next week. We don't know what's gonna happen, but just go there. Like I said, the bet is that Black Panther trailer will come next week. So if either it's going to be next week or I would have a cheeseburger hand, one or the other, you get the chance
to watch. I thought it was a taco.
Did we take pizza? Let's do pizza. I got waffle. Let's do waffles. Somebody put a picture of a waffle. I've been wanting a waffle all damn day. But yeah,
gluten free waffle.
Yeah,
with Cool Whip.
Like I said, until then, this is Leroy.
This is Eli.
We'll talk to you guys next week. Same bullet time, same bullet channel.
Ain't this what they've been waiting for? You ready? I used to pray for times like this, to rhyme like this, so I had to grind like that, to shine like this, in a matter of time I spent on some locked up shit, in the back of the paddy wagon, cuffs locked on wrist, see my dreams unfold, nightmares come true, it was time to marry the game, and I said, yeah, I do, if you want it, you gotta see it with a clear eye view. Got shorty, she try and bless me like I said I'd chew. Like a nigga sneeze, nigga please for them trick and squeeze. I'm getting cream, never let them hoes get in between of what we started. Little nigga, but I'm lying hearted. They love me when I was stuck and they hate it when I departed. I go and get it regardless. Draw like I'm an artist, no crawling. Went straight to walking with foreigns in my garages. All foreign bitches menaging, fucking sucking and swallowing anything for a dollar. They tell me get him, I got him. I did it without an album. I did shit with Mariah. Lil' nigga, I'm on fire. Icy as a hockey ring, Philly nigga, I'm flyer. When I bought the Rolls Royce, they thought it was lease. Then I bought that new Ferrari, hey, to rest in peace. Hey, to rest in peace, rest in peace to the parking lot. Phantom so big, can't even fit in the parking spot. You ain't talking about my niggas, then what you talking about? Gangsters move in silence, nigga, and I don't talk a lot. I don't say a word. I don't say a word. Was on my grind and now I got what I deserve. Fuck, nigga. Hold up, wait a minute. Y'all thought I was finished? When I bought the Aston Martin, y'all thought it was rented? Flexing on these niggas, I'm like Papa on the spinach. Double M, yeah, that's my team. Rose, the captain, I'm lieutenant. I'm the tight can of men casting grind like I'm broke. That Lambo, my new bitch, she don't ride like my ghost. I'm riding around my city with my hands strapped on my toes. Cause these niggas want me dead, and I gotta make it back home. Cause my mama need that bill money, my son need some milk. These niggas try to take my life, they fuck around, get killed. You fuck around, you fuck around, you fuck around, get smoked. Cause these Philly niggas I pull with me don't fuck around, no joke. No, all I know is murder. When it come to me, I got young niggas that's rolling. I got niggas throwing bees. I done did the DOA, I done did the KODs. Every time I'm in that bitch, I get to throwing 30 G's. But now I'm hanging out that drop head, I'm riding down no collar. They let my nigga earn back home, that young nigga be wildin'. We young niggas, we mobbin', like Batman and we're robbin'. This two-door Maybach with my seat on reclining. I'm like, real nigga, what up? Real nigga, what up? If you ain't about that murder game, then pussy nigga, shut up. If you dip me in your ass, I get your pussy ass stuck up. When you touch down in my hood, no, that tour life ain't good. Kept me down in MIA, and that heat game on wood. With that Puma life on my feet, like that little engine I could. Boy, I slide down in your block, bike on 12 o'clock. And they be throwing deuces on the same nigga they watch. And I'm the king of my city, cause I'm still calling them shots. And these lames talking that bullshit, the same niggas that flop. I'm the same nigga from First Street with them neck braids that lock. The same nigga that came up and I had to wait for my spot. And these niggas hating on me, hoes waiting on me. Still on that hood shit, my Rolls Royce on E, they gon' remember me. I say remember me. So much money, all your friends turn to your enemies. And when this beef, I turn my enemies to memories. With them bricks, they go for 40, ain't no 10 to key. Hold up, broke nigga turn rich. Love the game like Mitch. And if I leave, you think dumb pretty hoes gon' still suck my dick. It was something about that Rollie when it first touched my wrist. Had me feeling like that dope boy when he first touched that brick. I'm gone.